21. From that time, Jesus began to show his disciples that he must go to Jerusalem and suffer many things from the elders and chief priests and scribes and be killed, and on the third day be raised. And Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him, saying, "Far be it from you, Lord. This shall never happen to you." But he turned and said to Peter, "Get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man." Then Jesus told his disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. For whoever shall save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom." This is Jesus' first declaration that he is going to die. But right afterwards, we see that he also proclaims his rising from the dead. And then we see that this is outside of man's purview. This is not how man thinks. We're going to cover lots of stuff in this today. Let's just start from the beginning. It says, from this time, Jesus began to tell his disciples. From this time, says, going on, he's changing things. He had been ministering to the Gentiles and to the Jews predominantly for the rest of his ministry. And now he's going to change his course. Elders, the chief priests, and the scribes, which we've seen that he has had difficulties with in the past, but he's now telling them that they're actually going to succeed. It's not just going to be words that are in combat here. killed. When this occurs, when this is said that he will die, we see a shift in what men's idea of the Messiah is supposed to be. The Messianic servant, or the Messiah, was not thought to ever falter or fail in human eyes in the Old Testament, because they had made a mistake and separated out the good and the bad. The suffering servant from Isaiah and the Messiah, they had separated these out and said that they were two separate people. They had not reconciled that these, since the passages continue to flow with one another, were actually the same person. So when Peter steps up, takes him to the side and says, "Hey, Lord, this isn't how it works. This will not happen to you." There are several reasons for this. One of them is the misunderstanding that the prophets never said anything about the Messiah suffering, which we know is not true. But the other is also a difficulty with the phrase, "and the third day be raised." There's allusions in the Old Testament about the third day, all throughout it, and usually referring to a time of completion. So when the disciples are hearing the third day, they are hearing at the time of completion. The Messiah will rise from the dead. None of them are getting this, that there's 3 days and then he'll actually rise to life. So we have that difficulty as well. Peter's saying, yes, of course the Messiah will rise with the resurrection. Of course he would. He's the leader of the resurrection. But Jesus is speaking literally here. So when Peter takes him aside, says, "Far be it from you, Lord, this shall never happen to you." He speaks in what we would consider human wisdom. He speaks in wisdom that, according to all knowledge of the Old Testament at this time, was correct. We oftentimes jump on Peter and say, "Oh my goodness, you know, he's the hindrance here." But in reality, when you look at it, he's just speaking what most people would consider good advice. This is where one of our little side notes is going to happen today. We have the ability as Christians to believe that we are telling the truth. Believe that we are telling good things to those that are around us. And yet we can be a hindrance. We can cause others to falter. And many times it's because we come at it with a spirit of compassion without the spirit of God intermingled into it. Peter is coming at this saying, "No, this is not how the Messiah works. This is not my understanding of the Messiah, so therefore, it cannot work this way." But Peter's idea is the same as all the other apostles. Remember, Peter was the spokesman of the apostles. So he probably wasn't just hopping up there and talking all by himself. He was probably speaking for the rest of the apostles. In this, it says that Peter began to rebuke him. This word is only used two other times in the Gospel of Matthew, and they are both from Jesus, when Jesus rebuked rebuked a demon, and Jesus rebuked the wind and the sea for being out of control. So we start to see that Peter is not just simply saying, oh, no, you can't do this. This is a very emphatic statement. When you think about Jesus' rebukes of the wind, the sea, and the demon, this is how intense Peter is in this. And he believes himself to be correct. He believes himself to be wholeheartedly in the right. In verse 23, it says, but Jesus turned and said to Peter, get behind me, Satan. You are a hindrance or a stumbling stone to me, for you are not setting your mind on the things of God, but on the things of man. Jesus, first off, calls Peter the enemy, which is the translation of Satan here. The enemy. Get behind me, enemy. Then tells Peter that he is a hindrance or a stumbling stone. If you've ever looked at the word Peter, it's a translation of rock, right? So when Jesus before said, Peter, you are the rock on which I will build my church. Now we should see, and this is literally in the next chapter. Oh, no, never mind. This is the same chapter that Peter is now turned from the rock on which the foundation of the church is built to the stumbling stone. Because before, Peter spoke God's wisdom from God's perspective, and Jesus says that this was told to you by the Holy Spirit, and now he is now the hindering or the stumbling stone because his mind is not set on the things of God. How oftentimes do we let ourselves be drawn in and pulled away so quickly? In this instance, it is a matter of a day that Peter has this flip from being proclaimed as a rock and a sturdy place that many men would be able to go and look at to being a hindrance to the Messiah himself because his mind is not stayed there. So, in this, we see also that Jesus calls him Satan. Please do not interpret this as Jesus was saying that Peter is possessed by Satan. But as Pastor was talking about last week, we are very easily influenced by Satan when we are not thinking on the things of God. And this is where pointing in where he's pointing right now as he speaks and says, you are Satan at this time. You are a hindrance. And even though Jesus is going to continue on his march that he has just declared, he tells Peter that you are a hindrance. You actually slow me down right here. Satan is most likely trying to use the human thought, the human mind of Peter, to dissuade Jesus from what he has to do. To me, that's frightening, because I know that I have given counsel to many people, and I don't know if all that counsel was good. I don't know if I was in the right right, and I was truly focused on the Lord when I gave that counsel. This is one of the reasons why James tells us that it is imperative that we be focused on the Lord and the wisdom of the Lord and not the wisdom of man. From there, Jesus changes his perspective. He changes his perspective to now all those who are gathered there. He was speaking to Peter, and now he turns to the disciples. He begins to tell them life. How life is going to work on out from now on. Then Jesus told the disciples, "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me." First, he says, hey, if you want to be my disciples, if any of you want to come after me, you've got to do what I do. But the funny thing is, he's never told them that he is going to die on the cross. He has told them twice that they will have to pick up their cross and follow him. But he has never told them that he is going to die on a cross. He does not reveal that until later. But what does it mean for them to pick up a cross? Pick up a cross is very simple imagery. They would have seen it on a regular basis, that there's a guy carrying his cross, and you would have to carry your own cross to go and die on as a criminal in the Roman occupation. So it's very simple that you are now taking up what's going to kill you. Gospel is true in that sense. Oftentimes, we here in America, we don't have any persecution occurring. We do not feel that we would in any way lose our lives for the gospel. But this is true throughout history and throughout the world at this time. Because gospel does bring death. It either brings death spiritually to those who hear it and refuse it, or death to those who desire to spread it and those that want to destroy the gospel, seek out the only thing that they can destroy, which is our human lives. For whoever would save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake find it. For what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Or what shall a man give in return for his soul? For the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of the Father, and then he will repay each person according to what he has done. He starts to shift their idea. He says, you guys will go and die. This is a high probability. And as we know from history, 11 of the apostles of the 12 died a martyr's death. And John was imprisoned for life. He says, for whoever would save his life will lose it. But whoever loses his life for my sake will find it. This is both spiritual and physical. We know that God, when he tells us that if we give up our lives, if we die with Christ, we find life, we find abundant life. But we also see physically, this is the truth as well. If you give up your life physical manner, whether that be the hopes and dreams that you had or your true life that you have, to give it up for Christ, you will find a new life. You will find a life far more abundant than any measure that we could have. And then he points us back to his temptation. He says, what will it profit a man if he gains the whole world and forfeits his soul? Jesus had this temptation placed before him when Satan took him to the top of the mountain and said, look, all the kingdoms of the earth, I own them. I'll give them to you if you'll sit down and bow. You'll bow down and worship me. Christ is calling forward an idea that truly, it wouldn't matter if you had the entire world. When you die, it's all gone. When you die, you have lost your soul. You will not have it. He says, then what shall a man give in return for his soul? And we've looked at this in other times, that you cannot buy your soul. You don't own your soul. There are only two people that are capable of owning your soul. The things that you dwell on this world, Satan, sin, or Christ. Those are the only two things that can own your soul. So you can't even buy back your soul. Then he tells them, for the Son of Man is going to come with his angels in the glory of his Father. And then he will pay each person according to what he has done. Truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming in his kingdom. So he's been, honestly, rather depressing up until this point. He's telling them that they cannot do anything in their own strength in order to avoid the possibilities that he's presented here. He tells them that they cannot save their souls. But then he tells them that the Son of Man is going to come. The Son of Man will rise up and return. Now we can have a lovely discussion at any time outside of the pulpit about what this last verse implies. He says, truly I say to you, there are some standing here who will not taste death until they see the Son of Man coming. But that's not the key here. The key is that the Son of Man is coming. And all of Christendom agrees that the Son of Man is coming in glory, that he will repay each person according to what he has done. And this is why we don't have an option when it comes to preaching the gospel. We know the truth that God will come, Jesus will come as a judge of the world. And many of us are completely surrounded by people who are completely blind to this. Everywhere that we work, we walk, we talk. This is not disputed at all in the church. This is the truth of the gospel, that Christ will come again. There's time to wait and not present this to our friends, to our family, and to those around us that honestly we may not even know. Those that we walk into in the street or have a business transaction with. The Son of Man is coming. In verse 28, we see that there are several different possibilities, and I'll just cover those as a brief exit here. It says that they will not die until some of them will not die until they see the Son of God coming in his kingdom. There's four predominant possibilities here, depending on your views of eschatology and such, they change. But the first is the transfiguration, that is the next chapter. There are three disciples that see Jesus come in full glory on the Mount of Transfiguration. The other possibility is the resurrection, seeing as Judas would be dead at that time, him saying that some of you will see it and some of you won't, is perfectly accurate when he speaks of them not tasting death until the Son of Man is coming in his kingdom. The ascension, and even some debate the destruction of Jerusalem later on. No matter where you land in that, the truth of what he has said here, that we will suffer, we will die for the gospel, is not disputed. And one of the reasons why we do not have this occurring yet is the blessing of God in America. But that doesn't mean it won't happen here, even in our lifetime. But with that, we also have the proof that the disciples have, that God would come, and he did. Several of them saw it in whatever way that you interpret that as. They were all willing and ready to die for the gospel. Because it's worth it. Because we know the truth of the gospel and the glory of God that is displayed throughout the world each and every day. So I exhort you guys, let's carry it out. Seek out after his face, and seek out those who are lost in the world that is